Over the past two decades or so, fans have praised Budokai Tenkaichi 3 for its gameplay and its impressive roster, with many hailing it as the best DBZ game of all time. But with the release of the newest entry in the franchise, Sparking Zero, I wondered how well does Budokai Tenkaichi 3 hold up in comparison to its younger brother? Of course, it's to be expected. When a new game from the same series releases, there is to be updates, improvements made upon its predecessor, especially when the game in question was released 17 years later. Still, from my personal experience, many of the old school Dragon Ball games bring something to the table that the current generation just simply cannot replicate. So I thought we'd put my little theory to a test to see not only if Sparking Zero is the pinnacle of Dragon Ball gaming, but to see if Tenkaichi 3 still holds up. Comparisons between the two titans, including my opinion on which is the superior game, and of course the ins and outs of Tenkaichi 3 as a whole. Now, when starting off, you'll initially notice that the main menu screen, while being very presentable, does not hold a damn candle to that of Sparking Zero, which in all honesty is to be expected for an old school anime game. However, one factor that bothers me, at least a tad bit, is that there's far too many unnecessary game modes. For instance, certain options here, like, let's say, Character Encyclopedia, could have easily been put together with other non-battle-centric modes and a more presentable Extras mode or something of that sort. However, once you select Story Mode, that's when the game flourishes. The story here is separated neatly into distinct sagas, including ones you'd expect to see in any Dragon Ball title, like Saiyan, Frieza, Cell, and Buu. However, on your journey, you'll also unlock unique scenarios, which not only are absent from the game's successor, but some that are specific to this game entirely. Now, that's not to suggest, by any means, that Sparking Zero is lacking in this department. And if you've seen my videos, you know that I've previously praised that game for its ability to innovate and create a multitude of stories branching off the main campaign. What I'd really like to focus on here, though, is where Sparking Zero did end up falling short. And there's three specific sagas, we'll call them, in which I personally felt that it did. Firstly, and perhaps most apparently, OG Dragon Ball. One thing the newest Dragon Ball game lacked is not only Dragon Ball characters in general, but any real reference to the OG series whatsoever. In stark contrast, not only provides us with an, albeit brief, actual storyline for the Dragon Ball series, but a plethora of characters as well, some of which I had completely forgotten were in this game and was quite a welcome surprise to me. This includes the more obvious ones, like General Tao and King Piccolo, but the game also brings in some very rare cast from Goku's origins, like General Blue, Nam, Hater, and perhaps the biggest surprise of all, freaking Devilman. That is so bizarre. Now, for some fans, particularly those who grew up with Super, it may feel a bit silly to play as these characters who are considered a bit weaker in comparison to the likes of End of Z Goku, Gogeta, or Omega Shenron. But for us OG fans, and I'm speaking on the ones who grew up with DBZ and Dragon Ball running simultaneously on Toonami, the good old days, man. Or perhaps even older fans who were aware of the series from its original Japanese run. If you fall into either one of those categories, then I know for a fact that this was an absolute treat. Sure, there's a good possibility that Sparking Zero will add more OG Dragon Ball characters to the mix in the form of DLC. And honestly, I really hope they do. But for now, and also a bonus, these characters are in the base game. That's a big, big point for Tenkaichi 3. The second saga in question, Dragon Ball GT. Now, to be fair, Sparking Zero does add a significant amount of GT characters to the mix, enough to at least warrant this, my personal opinion, being a controversial take. But regardless, I'm gonna stand on business. The fact that GT has its own story here is really cool, and I definitely appreciated playing through it because, let's be real guys, GT in itself isn't bad. I mean, those first 20 episodes or so, I mean, that's arguably pretty trash. There's some pretty solid battles and villains in the series as a whole, one of which, Super 17, makes his grand appearance here, and for some odd reason, not in Sparking Zero. Now, Super 17 is one of the three main villains in that entire series, so I did find his exclusion from Sparking Zero to be quite strange, and as many have pointed out, he's likely to be one of the first major candidates for a DLC release, but still, it is really weird he was excluded from the base game. The last saga that Tenkaichi Tenkaichi 3 did better was the movies. Not only do they include some movie characters that aren't in Sparking Zero, like Base 4 and Garlic Jr. for instance, but there's an entire scenario for movie villains, played in order from Bardock vs. Frieza all the way through Harutegaard. Some of these movies even consisting of two separate episodes, usually occurring when the good guys get stopped the fuck out by the likes of Broly or even Bojack, and you get the unique experience to relive some of these awesome moments in the game. It's worth pointing out that this also occurs in the main timeline sagas, where a villain will unanimously win the battle, usually against a plethora of Z fighters. And in this scenario, you'll switch back and forth between them and the heroes. Some examples of this are when Frieza dominates the Z Warriors on Namek, and also when Cell does the exact same thing on Earth. Some might say I'm being a bit nitpicky here with the whole story mode and lack thereof, but I truly don't think that's the case. The devs here likely felt that they need to cut the OG and certain GT characters from the roster just to save room for the, of course, plethora of super characters that were introduced to the series in Sparking Zero. And although this is very valid, as it's new and they're very fun to play with, I do still wish they worked on finding a better middle ground here. But again, in this day and age, I guess that's what DLC is for. In contrast, Sparking Zero excels in taking the story of Dragon Ball to new heights, creating so many unique opportunities to deviate from the original and traditional Z and Super storylines, even introducing some brand new villains into the mix as allowed, like Gohan Black, which I thought was absolutely sick. This, in my opinion, is badass and kind of makes up for the fact they missed the mark on a lot of the original material. I mean, realistically, the base game can only be so big. If you do want to hear more of my takes on Sparking Zero as a whole, I made multiple videos on that game already, and I'll leave some of the links up here. Somewhere up there, I'm not good at that. In terms of the overall roster though, it's a competitive landscape for sure. Again, as mentioned previously, Sparking Zero did remove many Dragon Ball, GT, and even certain versions of movie villains from the mix just due to the overwhelming amount of super characters that were introduced. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's a worse game for that. It felt nothing short of refreshing playing through the story of Super in Budokai / Tenkaichi format. And finally, utilizing those new characters who, in all reality, are a decade old at this point. For the first time in this environment, really made it feel like we were entering a new era in the Dragon Ball universe. However, while this is the case, in terms of each player's combat, many, and I mean many features are carried over. Like the plethora of unique forms certain characters have, which allow you to utilize different movesets, super attacks, and even ultimates. The DP formats, in which a player is allowed a maximum of 15 points per team to help restore some balance to the game and prevent players from using only the broken characters. Even the mechanics, like teleporting behind an enemy as they attack or chain teleporting to enhance your combo. But at this point, many of you are probably thinking, duh. This is basically Budokai Tenkaichi 4. Not even basically, it literally is. I figured these similarities were still worth pointing out, as the original Budokai trilogy had some stark differences in its combat between the three. But that being said, I still haven't played Budokai Tenkaichi 1 or 2 in years. And I mean, over a decade. So perhaps they did make some major improvements over that trilogy. And if that's the case, and this video here does well, then we'll find out together. This relates to the supers and ultimates as well, as many of them are carried over from Tenkaichi 3 to Sparking Zero. However, the graphical upgrades and choreography make these slight differences feel so much more apparent, and something about that Sparking Zero moveset is just so top tier, that without much question or thought, I have to give this one to Sparking Zero. I also felt it was worth briefly touching on the difficulty between the games. Now that being said, Dragon Ball games were never known, to me at least, for their difficulty. I mean, sure, in comparison to some other anime or even fighting games in general, Dragon Ball games may have a bit more of a challenge, at least in the past. But newer games like Kakarot felt so lacking in that department, especially prior to the DLCs. However, Tenkaichi 3 certainly does deliver in difficulty. I mean, normal mode is no joke. Omega Shenron threw my ass for a loop multiple times, and Kid Buu was not to be taken lightly. But still, when compared to the unexpected level of challenge found in Sparking Zero, overall at least, the difficulty just doesn't compare. Sparking Zero had so many battles that me and many other players felt were a little bit too difficult for their own good, to the point of nearly rage quitting without going back to easy mode, and I would never. And at least in Tenkaichi 3, Grade 8 Vegeta is a reasonable fight. I do also like the method of finding Dragon Balls in Tenkaichi 3 just a bit more in comparison to that of Sparking Zero. I mean, breaking destructible environments and just happening to run into them feels so much more rewarding in comparison. Now, there's a lot more I could say, but since this video is getting a tad bit long, and well, I do want to save some of my thoughts for a potential future standalone Tenkaichi 3 video, I figured it's best to just wrap up here and give our overall thoughts on the comparisons and contrasts between Budokai Tenkaichi 3 and Sparking Zero. First off, it goes without saying, and without question, that both of these titans will go down in Dragon Ball history, with Budokai Tenkaichi 3 holding the record for the biggest roster for decades, and the long anticipated Sparking Zero delivering on almost all of its promises, and then some, to the fans. And before I make my decision, I want to say it is truly difficult to decide which is better, or even which of the two that I personally prefer. As mentioned throughout the video, Tenkaichi 3 has a lot to offer to us OG fans, shedding light on some characters that we rarely, if ever, get to utilize, like the impressive OG Dragon Ball roster, which again is severely lacking in Sparking Zero. I can only hope we get a really big OG Dragon Ball DLC pack for that game. Take my damn money. But in contrast, the Sparking Zero roster gives us more characters overall and a plethora of unique and never before seen characters in the Budokai / Tenkaichi universe, each being equipped with some very unique and impressive fighting styles, supers, and ultimates that ultimately give it the slight advantage, in my opinion, over Budokai Tenkaichi 3, all nostalgia aside. The combat in Sparking Zero is really the natural evolution to Budokai Tenkaichi 3, expanding upon it while being careful to keep the core mechanics in place that originally made the 2007 title so massively popular. So in terms of mechanics, we just naturally have to give this to Sparking Zero as well. Lastly, the story mode itself is perhaps the most difficult of the bunch, but the overall reasoning for my decision goes hand in hand with many of the topics we discussed previously. While I do genuinely love and appreciate Tenkaichi 3 for including a Dragon Ball, Dragon Ball GT, and a complete movie villain storyline, the Sparking Zero story not only includes a complete super storyline as well, but also takes such a unique spin on the franchise, allowing you to alter the story in so many ways based on the choices that you make. Well, in my opinion, that's just really innovative for a Dragon Ball game and helps Sparking Zero stand out so much among not just Dragon Ball, but anime games in general. So in my personal opinion, again, while I'll always love Tenkaichi 3 and still continue to play it to this day because while it offers a host of things that Sparking Zero just lacks, at the end of the day, what it comes down to is that Sparking Zero is just more of a complete package and just a better game in general. But again, that's just my opinion. Don't come for me, old heads. Please, I'm one of you. But what's most important here is what you guys think. Do you guys agree with my takes here? Do you guys disagree? Is everything I said completely irrelevant? Are you gonna unsubscribe? Let me know in the comments below. And if you guys did enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe, so I know to make more Tenkaichi based videos. I would love to do a complete trilogy next. So if it does well, that'll be in my upcoming videos. But yeah, until next time, thank you as always. Peace.
I am the Prince of Saiyans.